This album is 20 years old. Limp Bizkit's Significant Other, an album that helped define the new metal and new rock genre, is 20 years old, June 22nd. I can't believe this album is that old. Now, I'm going to talk about this album tonight. I'm going to talk about it in 2019 and see, does it hold up? What are the pros? What are the cons? And I'm going to do all this ignoring all the exterior factors that surrounded this album, whether it be Woodstock, Limp Bizkit's awful Woodstock 99 debacle, everybody in the world pretty much hating Fred Durst, and the whole bro frat skater culture that surrounded the late 90s and this album at that time. I'm going to try to throw all that out the window and just focus on the album and the music, and just see how does this hold up in 2019. So stick around, this is the Overstimulation Station. Hey! So Limp Bizkit came about in my hometown of Jacksonville, Florida. That's right, they are hometown heroes. Should I be excited about that? I'll leave that up for you to decide. As some of you may or may not know, I also reside currently in Jacksonville, Florida. I was born and raised here. And just a little brief history of Limp Bizkit. They were a local band that grew very popular, playing at a place called the Milk Bar here in town, which is no longer here. I was even too young to have ever gone to or have seen the Milk Bar, but they got really popular really fast in Jacksonville. Korn came to Jacksonville sometime, I believe, around 1997, I want to say. Oh, I could be wrong on that exact date. But anyway, long story short, Fred Durst schmoozed his way into talking to the band, got Fieldy, the bass player from Korn, to listen to their demo tape, which were songs that would have eventually made it onto Limp Bizkit's first album, $3 Bill, Y'all. Fieldy liked what he heard. Limp Bizkit went on tour with Korn. Limp Bizkit got signed to Flip, which was a division of Interscope Records. They released their first album, $3 Bill, Y'all. It did okay. They had the song Counterfeit on there and the cover of the George Michael song Faith, and that song eventually got on the radio. They got a little bit of popularity off of that, but when they went into the studio and released this album that came out in 1999, this would really be the album that would break Limp Bizkit as a band, and this was when I first started hearing about the band. Now, the first time I actually heard Limp Bizkit was my friends were going on and on about their song on the Now That's What I Call Music Volume 3 compilation, which was a song called Nookie. I will get into Nookie and what I think about it a little bit later, but now all that's out of the way, let's dive into the actual track listings here and kind of do a brief overview of every track on the album. Now, the album starts out with a song called Intro, which is just a little electronic loop with a little electronic kind of drum pad thing with this down-pitched vocoder sound. Now, I will note the vocoder voice is saying, "You wanted the worst, you got the worst, the one, the only Limp Bizkit," which is a playoff of the band Kiss at their live show saying, "You wanted the best, you got the best, here's Kiss." So it's kind of a play on that. So after Intro, we get into the first proper song of the album, which is a song called Just Like This. It starts out with a very strong drum groove by drummer John Otto, and then Wes Borland comes in with a signature big Limp Bizkit guitar riff. The song kicks in proper, and you really kind of hear how Limp Bizkit, if you say nothing else about Limp Bizkit, you can at least say that they were pretty damn good at coming up with heavy metal grooves, and this song felt like a very strong start into the album. Then the song transitions into the song Nookie, which, again, who hasn't heard this song at this point? It was Nookie by Limp Bizkit and Freak on a Leash by Korn, I am convinced, that really ushered in the new rock sound onto mainstream radio, because these songs were both in heavy rotation, Freak on a Leash still being played all the time. I don't really hear Nookie on the radio as much anymore, but This song was very experimental. I understand why I liked it. I can see why, as a kid, I liked this song. Especially when you consider the fact that we had never heard this kind of experimental, heavy style of music on mainstream radio before. The verses were very stark, with a kind of a more of a sampled type beat. Not a whole lot of actual real instrumentation, a lot of electronic type stuff. And then the chorus kicks in really hard with very heavy guitar. The bridge has this very creepy, crawly, almost Tool-like quality to it. And you'll see a lot of the influence in this album came heavily from the band Tool, which might sound like sacrilege to some, especially big Tool fans, to even put Limp Bizkit anywhere near Tool. But if you take Fred Durst's awful vocals out of the equation, musically, Tool and Limp Bizkit are a lot more similar than a lot of people would like to believe. And bad lyrics are going to be a huge theme in this video, so strap yourselves in for me to complain about that a lot. The next song after Nookie is the iconic break stuff. I mean, this guitar riff is probably one of the most iconic nu metal riffs out of all the nu metal riffs that have existed for the past 20 years. I think this song is everybody's guilty pleasure from Limp Bizkit. This song is kind of undeniable. Now again, the only thing ruining the song is Fred Durst's sophomoric elementary lyrics with such lines as, "I have a chainsaw, I'll skin your ass raw," which, if you think that's bad, lyrically strap yourselves in, because as I said before, this is only the beginning of Fred Durst's bad lyrics. But the song Break Stuff is a pretty undeniable song, a lot of raw energy, and is just one of those songs that you find yourself grooving to. The next track after Break Stuff is a song called Rearrange. Great track listing, by the way. This album has a very intelligent track placement. Rearrange feels like a very well-needed break after the 2 or 3 song onslaught that we've received so far. It's got a nice jazzy bass guitar arpeggio riff played by bass player Sam Rivers, and then there's all kinds of haunting ambient vibes from Wes Borland's high-end guitar work up high up on the neck, with the delay-soaked and reverb-soaked tones, and DJ Lethal doing whatever the hell he does in the band to add that kind of creepy atmosphere. Fred Durst's vocals and lyrics in this song feel a lot more honest and a lot more mature, for lack of better words, which it feels good. I mean, it's a rare opportunity that you'll get that in this album. And the song has a really big, heavy guitar crescendo towards the end of the song, and it ends by the various elements of the song slowly fading out, like the guitar, heavy guitar fading out, and leaving only the bass, the jazzy bass groove with John Otto's funky drumming and DJ Lethal doing some scratching, until finally it just leaves Sam Rivers playing a lone drum groove. The next song is called I'm Broke, which, you know, again, it starts out with a very tight metal groove played by Wes Borland, the king of tight nu metal grooves. The chorus that it transitions into is a lot more loose and a lot more free-flowing. Wes Borland is playing this creepy carnival-style melody on his guitar, and there's all kinds of creepy ambience in the background, possibly played by DJ Lethal. It's a very big chorus, but once again, I feel it is ruined by Fred Durst's lyrical content. This song is about Fred Durst complaining about people not paying him back when he loans them money, and now he's broke. And there's such lyrics in this song as, "You should get a slappin' for slackin', or smackin' for slackin'." The raps are just very, again, elementary, not good. I can only imagine what this would have sounded like with either better lyrics or a better singer on it, but anyway, I digress. We move on into the next track called Nobody Like You. Again, song opens up with a trademark Wes Borland nu metal riff. It's like they never ran out of really good, tight, creative nu metal riffs. The well was full back at this time. Everything hadn't been played out in this genre yet. Now, if you were wondering if Limp Bizkit and Korn were ever in bed together musically and from a producer standpoint, this track leaves no more mystery to that. This song sounds straight up like a Korn song. I mean, you even have Jonathan Davis, lead singer of Korn, doing vocals in the verse. And like I said, I mean, Limp Bizkit already had a similar sound to Korn. Limp Bizkit tended to be more on the hip-hop groove side than Korn were, but on this song, by the time the verse kicks in, they are just straight Korn ripoff band, which I guess is fine because John Davis of Korn is doing vocals in the verse. And then randomly in some of the choruses in this song, we have Scott Weiland from Stone Temple Pilots contributing his vocals, which they stick out like a sore thumb. They don't sound bad because Scott Weiland's a great vocalist, but what a bizarre choice to have in a nu metal album, one of the founding bands in the grunge movement. The two styles don't really mesh all that well together. The next track is a song called Don't Go Off Wandering, and it starts out with this very dissonant, kind of creepy sounding violins or orchestra type thing. And then it breaks into your kind of typical Limp Bizkit verse at this point, you know, the very melodic Sam Rivers with his arpeggiated kind of bass guitar runs, and Wes Borland doing his upper, on the high up on the guitar neck things, adding atmosphere and mood to the song. John Otto refusing to play a simple downbeat. He's all on the upbeat and the offbeat and all that. For the chorus of the song, you have probably one of the more hook-laden choruses, or one of my more favorite choruses, from Fred Durst, the "You don't feel nothing at all." I thought that was a really nice chorus hook. Fun fact, the original demo of this song had Serge Tankian from System of a Down, actually doing vocals in the bridge of this song. You can find that on YouTube. I might cut it in here real quick, but yeah, he had all kinds of people on this album apparently. The next song on the album is a song called 1999. This essentially feels like Nookie Part 2. It's got the stark, talk rappy verses with the slammy, heavy guitar driven choruses. The song lyrically is apparently about the impending doom following Y2K, or the hope for a better decade or something. I don't know. It's honestly one of the weakest tracks on the album, musically and vocally, as far as I'm concerned. After 1999, the band puts down their instruments and we have a fully electronic, hip-hop produced track called End Together Now. This song mainly consists of a harp sample with a G-funk style bass and guitar groove. This song is a full-fledged rap song. There is no guitars, there's no distortion, this is just full-on, straight hip-hop. I know hip-hop heads will cringe at me even saying this is a straight-up hip-hop song, but I mean, if you were to classify it in a genre, that's what it would be. This features Wu-Tang Clan's Method Man heavily rapping in the song with Fred and Method trading off verses, although it becomes abundantly clear who the more talented rapper is in this scenario, with Method Man making Fred Durst, you know, inadvertently look like a novice. Fred Durst's raps in this track are really weak. If you went out and tried to write a rap song right now and just rhymed a bunch of stuff together, it would probably be very similar to the skill level of Fred Durst on this song and many other songs. His rapping is embarrassing, and God, I wish he had just stuck to the singing and the vocals, you know, in that style, because I feel like he's not a bad screamer and I don't mind him as a singer, honestly. The next track on this album, called Trust? Is one of my favorite big Limp Bizkit riffs. The musicians in this band are really bringing some good stuff to the table, and it only just makes you wish so bad that like a different vocalist was on this album, because the music was just so it's like the way they made such heavy riffs groove so hard was really like a hallmark of Limp Bizkit's musical style, and they pulled it off good in this song. However, Fred disappoints yet again with his bad lyrics, and I feel like the chorus hook on this song is really weak. I'm too fucking good, too fucking proud. I'ma show you how bad it hurts to be a clown. Just kind of felt like that was a weaker hook of theirs. The next song is, lyrically one of the worst songs in the album. It's called No Sex. It starts off with a creepy crawly Borland guitar riff that, very cool. I'm strapped in for what I'm about to hear. And it is quickly ruined by Fred Durst's kind of attempt at some kind of meaningful contemplative look at his sex life or his bad sex escapades with lyrics such as, should have left my pants on next time, but instead you had to let me dive right in, and was it my ass or your perfume that made sex hard to refuse? I don't want to think about Fred Durst's disgusting ass. I just imagine his personal hygiene isn't good or wasn't good at that time. If you ever saw the guy, just looked like a greasy skater punk. But the hook in the chorus was really good. Should have left my pants on next time, but instead you had to let me dive right in. I thought it was pretty decent, but the lyrics are so stupid that you feel kind of embarrassed listening to it. And I also really, just even as a kid, I remember thinking it was fucked up that in the song, lyrically, Fred is placing the blame for his apparent sex addiction on the women. Like, you have to let me dive right in, like, it's your fault. He's even saying in the kind of outro chorus or outro bridge that realize that I'm worth more than that. It's like, bitch, you're the one. It takes two to tango. You're saying it's all on the girl. It's all the girl's fault, right? You have no responsibility in this. Just typical Fred Durst douchery that everyone's come to expect at this point. The next song is a song called Show Me What You Got, which is an example of how Limp Bizkit can take a heavy jam and just flip it upside down from the intro to the verse. It's got this sparse chromatic run by Wes Borland on the guitar. It's got some tasty double stops by Sam Rivers on the bass guitar. And then John Otto's just got some fat groove going on. And again, it's ruined by Limp Bizkit's awful lyrics. Or not Limp Bizkit, but Fred Durst. Do you want an example? I left my heart in Austin with Mary Campbell. Got lost in Boston looking for the tea party. Met a child molester in Worcester. Need a Kleenex every time I'm leaving Phoenix. I get silly when I play in Philly. Limp Bizkit's committee down in Kansas City. Never know what I'm in for when I play in Denver. Hard rock don't stop down in Vegas. In Cincinnati, the girls call me daddy. And he also says, I spit on a boy named Tina in Pasadena. Okay, you get the picture. It's fucking awful. And then the second verse is just him kind of thanking all the bands that he played with and just name-dropping a bunch of people like Eminem and Les Claypool and, you know, people he worked with on the record and everything. Musically it's good, but yet again, Fred ruins it. The final proper song of this album, I guess, is a song called A Lesson Learned, which, again, the band is putting down their instruments for. This is a more electronic, trip-hop sounding song with an electronic kind of loop, and it's kind of a creepy song. Fred Durst is just kind of crooning in this very kind of dissonant tone about how he's got this pain in his stomach that won't go away, and you know, the dark side of fortune and fame, and it seems for maybe a second that just maybe Fred Durst has a glimmer of self-awareness, of putting down or turning away from his frat douche punk ways, but as we will hear on the next album, Chocolate Starfish in the Hot Dog Flavored Water, with songs like Keep Rolling, 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 that Limp Bizkit was in full-fledged frat douche rock mode still. The final track is a song called Outro, which basically is just like the intro track. It's an electronic kind of loop with that down-pitched vocoder saying, you wanted the worst, you got the worst. Then it's, they call out the Backstreet Boys. It's like, if you want the best, go buy a fucking Backstreet Boy album. Which, you know, that's a great way to make your album seem timeless, is to call out a band or a group that was relevant in a certain chunk of time, and that will no longer be relevant anymore. I mean, you know, good on you. Yeah, call out a band that, or a boy band that would be relevant maybe 3 years after that album came out. So that is a breakdown of the tracks. The album artwork, I always thought, was pretty cool. It was very reminiscent of that time period, and it kind of expressed the style of the band. Fred Durst was really into the spray painting and the tagging of trains and walls and all kinds of other things, you know. So the packaging kind of fit what you were going to hear. The inside of the album, I don't know, the CD is supposed to look like a little UFO, I guess, with the little alien in there. The back of the album, it looks like some kind of late 90s digital rendering that probably looked cool and futuristic at the time, but now looks dated as all hell. It looks like graphics from a PlayStation 1 cutscene. This is an enhanced CD, and it has video, basically a time-lapse video of the artist spray painting the cover art. These enhanced CDs were kind of a novel thing at the time. You could put the CD into your computer and a customized little menu would come up, and it was usually just useless bullshit like 3 or 4 JPEGs of the band or some little video that really wasn't of any consequence. Because if it was, they probably wouldn't put it as just like a hidden Easter egg on the CD. But kind of my final analysis of this album is, for that time, for that era of music, it was very innovative, and I can totally understand and see why Limp Bizkit got so big. It was very experimental music, and it was mixing the hip-hop elements that were popular with the rock elements, the nu metal elements, and it just sounded fresh. I mean, you couldn't deny that about Limp Bizkit at the time. Now, the soul thing that I've been hearing all through the years when it comes to Limp Bizkit, and the thing that I kept hitting myself over the head with the whole time listening to this album, was, goddamn, Fred Durst is awful. The band is awesome and Durst is awful. That's what everyone has always said about Limp Bizkit. Their musicians were great. Fred Durst ruined it. And God, is that the most truest statement I've ever heard. The whole time I'm like, man, musically I'd still be fucking with this, but it's Fred Durst's elementary pee-pee-poo-poo-caca type lyrics that just make me cringe. They're cringeworthy. His lyrics are cringy as fuck, and they make you not want to listen to it. And, I mean, that's really what it boils down to with Limp Bizkit. That's why they have the reputation they have. And apparently Fred Durst was an asshole to every single person who mattered back then to get them essentially blacklisted. But I don't know. I think Fred's awful lyrics really dated the album, or made it kind of a product of the late 90s, when that kind of frat boy-ism was running rampant and it was more acceptable back then. I think now in 2019, people wouldn't tolerate this music for a second. Even in the hip-hop community, I feel like hip-hop's gotten more introspective and less corny, I guess, lyrically. You really need to listen to the lyrics on this album. Like, 75 to 85% of them are pretty damn bad. So, I don't know. I think musically, it's still could hold a candle to a band like Tool or someone like that, who is still respected in the rock world. But lyrically, it is that is the album's Achilles tendon. So give the album a listen. There's still some enjoyment to be had. But if you can ignore the lyrics, then it's great. I hope you enjoyed watching this video and this retrospective on Significant Other. If there's any other albums you'd want me to do a retrospective on or take a look at, let me know, and I will consider it. Till next time, have a good rest of your night.